Hello, anatomy colleagues. This is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we are talking the very basics of every single cranial nerve, so 12 pairs of them in all. You will get more details as pertinent throughout the curriculum, and some we've already discussed in detail. Vagus, anyone? But this learning objective is meant to be a quick overview of basic function. So the basics will include the name as well as the Roman numeral associated with them, basic characteristics of each, so understanding what fibers make up the nerve. Is it sensory fibers, motor fibers, or both? And then, of course, we need to get a basic understanding of what these nerves will innervate. So this may seem like a lot, but I hope this feels more like a nice leisurely stroll through the cranial nerves instead. So let's get started. Recall that the cranial nerves are a component of the peripheral nervous system, as these are nerves, thus nervous tissue outside the central nervous system. There are 12 pairs in all, so quite a few less than what we have with spinal nerves. Recall there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And they're also different from spinal nerves, which are composed of both sensory and motor fibers. Some of the cranial nerves are composed of only sensory fibers or only motor fibers, while some will have both sensory and motor. The cranial nerves are closely associated with what are called cranial nerve nuclei, which are groups of neurons in the brain where the efferent fibers originate and afferent fibers will terminate. So as you might have guessed, we're going to start with cranial nerve 1 and make our way to cranial nerve 12. So what is cranial nerve 1? Why, it's the olfactory nerve, of course. This nerve is entirely sensory. In fact, it is what we call special sensory. So what does that even mean? Why is it so special? All this means is that this nerve, or any special sensory nerve, is composed of axons or fibers transmitting unique sensations. Think of the 5 senses you likely grew up learning, plus some bonuses. And it's a little bit more complex than that, but I think for our purposes, that's where we're going to go. The olfactory nerve is associated with the sense of smell. So sensation of odors that results from the detection of odorous substances aerialized from the environment. The origin and journey of the olfactory nerves and associated structures, such as the olfactory bulbs and the olfactory tracts, which you can see here. It's typically these olfactory tracts that are the most grossly visible component of the olfactory nerves. So it's pretty complex, but for our purposes, we want you to understand that the olfactory nerve is cranial nerve 1 and is composed of special sensory fibers associated with the sense of smell. Also entirely sensory, and special sensory to boot, is the optic nerve, or cranial nerve 2, which functions in vision, as you would probably guess from the name. The optic nerve begins where the axons of the retinal ganglion pierce the sclera, and so the sclera is the whites of the eyes, and we'll talk about this in great detail in the next session. From here, the optic nerve will exit the optic canal to enter the middle cranial fossa, where there will be this formation of the optic chiasm, which you can see a bit of it here. It's been cut. And fibers from the medial half of each retina will decussate or cross in the chiasm and join uncrossed fibers from the other side. So this partial crossing of certain optic nerve fibers is essential in binocular vision. So a bit more to come on this in the next session. Moving to cranial nerve 3, or the oculomotor nerve, which is, unlike the other two, entirely motor or efferent. The oculomotor nerve sends somatic motor fibers to all extraocular eye muscles except for 2, the superior oblique and the lateral rectus, which are going to be innervated by different cranial nerves. So up until now, the only cranial nerve that we knew had parasympathetic fibers was the vagus. Well, that is about to change because the oculomotor nerve also has preganglionic parasympathetic fibers associated with it, and it will synapse in the ciliary ganglion, which is within the orbital region. And it is, those postganglionic fibers are destined for the ciliary muscles and the sphincter papillae muscle. So the ciliary muscle plays a role in terms of accommodation, so keeping things in focus. And the sphincter papillae muscle does exactly what it sounds like it will do. It will constrict the pupil. It will eventually split into superior and inferior divisions, the oculomotor nerve, which you can see the inferior division right here. And so more to come on the oculomotor as well in the next session of the orbit and eye. Next, we have the trochlear nerve or cranial nerve 4, which is also is going to be entirely motor or efferent. This is the smallest cranial nerve, and it will innervate the superior oblique muscle, which is one of the extraocular eye muscles. Excuse me. The trochlear nerve is named for the trochlea, which is associated with the superior oblique muscle. So it kind of helps change the direction of the tendon for the muscle. This nerve is unique in the fact that it emerges from the posterior aspect of the brainstem. So it's the only one that looks like it's kind of poking out from that posterior region and wrapping around. All right, our first nerve with both afferent and efferent fibers. And this also happens to be the largest cranial nerve, and this is the trigeminal nerve, or cranial nerve 5. It's divided into three divisions, which are quite large as well. Two of the three divisions are entirely sensory. These are V1, or the ophthalmic nerve, you can see here. V2, also known as the maxillary nerve. These are entirely sensory, whereas V3 is going, or the mandibular nerve, has both afferent and efferent fibers. And those efferent fibers are going to be associated with the muscles of mastication or chewing muscles, in addition to a few neighboring muscles. The trigeminal nerve will provide afferent innervation to a relatively huge expanse of area, so including but not limited to the skin of the face, teeth, gingiva, paranasal sinuses, and portions of the mouth. So a very large, very important nerve associated with the head. The abducens nerve, or cranial nerve 6, is relatively simple compared to the trigeminal nerve. This nerve is entirely efferent and will innervate the lateral rectus muscle. So here's your abducens, here's your lateral rectus, which is one of the extraocular eye muscles. The lateral rectus muscle will abduct the eye, thus the name abducens. Recall that the abducens nerve is the cranial nerve that travels directly through the cavernous sinus near the internal carotid artery before exiting the superior orbital fissure to enter the orbital region. The facial nerve, or cranial nerve 7, is another nerve that has both sensory and motor fibers. The sensory fibers include special sensory fibers for tastes to the anterior 2/3 of the tongue, so anterior portion of the tongue. The somatic motor fibers innervate muscles of facial expression. So how we change the expressions in our face, it's because these muscles are contracting, as well as a few neighboring muscles. And you will see all these small branches kind of throughout in this image here. These are all branches of the facial nerve, heading to those muscles of facial expression. And that's really where it gets its name. The visceral motor fibers include preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, which will synapse in peripheral parasympathetic ganglia. And these are going to send fibers to initiate secretion from the lacrimal gland, so thinking tears, as well as the submandibular and sublingual glands, so thinking salivary glands or secreting saliva. So a very, very complex nerve here in the facial nerve. One of my favorite cranial nerves is cranial nerve 8, or vestibulocochlear nerve, which is entirely sensory, specifically special sensory, involved in hearing and equilibrium. The vestibulocochlear nerve will enter into the internal acoustic meatus, so heading into the petrous part of the temporal bone, and it will divide into cochlear and vestibular nerve. So you can see the cochlea here. The glossopharyngeal nerve is cranial nerve 9 and has both afferent and efferent fibers, and there is a lot going on with the glossopharyngeal nerve. There are going to be special sensory fibers for taste for the posterior one-third of the tongue. So whereas the facial nerve is going to have special sensory fibers for the anterior two-thirds, it's the glossopharyngeal that has the posterior one-third. It will also provide general sensory fibers for that area. We already know that the glossopharyngeal provides sensory innervation to the pharynx. We talked about that in great detail, but it's been a while since we did, so it's time for a reminder. Additionally, there will be preganglionic parasympathetic fibers that originate in the glossopharyngeal. So we've had that in oculomotor, facial, glossopharyngeal, and then of course vagus. Those are the four nerves, that have parasympathetics associated with them. And so these preganglionic parasympathetic fibers are going to synapse in the otic ganglion, and it will be heading towards the largest salivary gland, the parotid gland. So will initiate secretion of saliva. And lastly, it provides somatic motor innervation for the stylopharyngeus, which we can see right here, and hopefully we recall that from the pharynx session. At this point, I hope you are very familiar with the vagus nerve or cranial nerve 10. In fact, we've already described the major roles of the vagus nerve throughout the year. But if you need a review of this very complex nerve, you have this short summary here. The accessory nerve or cranial nerve 11 we have also discussed as being entirely efferent or motor, and it will innervate the muscles sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius muscles. This nerve was traditionally called the spinal accessory nerve, so you may hear it referred to in that way. And last, but certainly not least, we have the hypoglossal nerve or cranial nerve 12. And when you think of hypoglossal nerve, I want you to think efferent and I want you to think tongue. So it is going to innervate the muscles of the tongue, both extrinsic and intrinsic muscles, except for one. But for the most part, just generalized, think tongue muscles. All right, excellent. We have made it to the summary slide with everyone's favorite, a nice, beautiful table that succinctly summarizes the information we discussed in this video. Please do take time to review on your own, and always feel free to reach out with any questions. Have a great rest of your day.